Give me the book, or I'll kill you all! Don't threaten us, and get off our roof!
Welcome, everyone. Welcome to our show. Today's program is all about hidden treasure. Got your attention, huh?
The ninjas have been ordered in to make things even more difficult. If they force an athlete against the dome, his opponent gets the point.
Ninja, penetrate the dome.
The early 90s were a busy time for video game development, in more than just one way. It was a time where games that are now considered bedrock, precursor genetics to more recent and more advanced titles, were new and hot and inspiring members of a young generation with the new possibilities of what a well-developed game could play like. But it was also a time where computer tech was rapidly evolving, despite the relatively constrained and, frankly, outdated by comparison console hardware. Games on cartridge originally happens because quite literally jamming a circuit board into a hardware slot made just for that was one of the better options for safely transporting data and media. Not to mention that the much vaunted 16-bit hardware of both the SNES and Genesis? 16-bit tech is vintage the mid-80s. It was in no way the leap in power they made it out to be, blast processing or no. Bit numbers, as they were used in marketing, were always bullshit. So alongside these older, now venerated systems and their established hardware, new consoles began emerging, with new features and new capabilities. Many of these new systems used something that was, at the time, changing the way that we engaged with our technology. The CD-ROM. This was the time when the term multimedia was the hot buzzword, the signifier that your thing, whatever it was, wasn't simply a thing. It was an experience. Look out! More than one of your senses will be engaged by this thing. Try not to be crushed by the majesty displayed by the talking wall of CDI.
I take it you're the wall?
The Great Wall.
As you are challenged to both look and listen and touch all at once. In this new frontier of technology, innovators did what they did when handed a new tool to work with. They explored it to see what it was good at, what the capabilities of it were. Some folks took the long route to try and really understand the sort of power they were working with under the hood. Others had their own idea of what this physical medium should be used for, and that's movies. Except movies that you play. Movies where you are the boxer in first person. It's like Raging Bull. Except an AVI file of a southpaw, and no self-destruction subplot to drag down the proceedings. Don't say it didn't turn heads, because it straight up did, entirely on the fact that games didn't commonly do this sort of stuff until this technology happened. Myst sold because of what CDs could do, the degree of experience they could provide artists to players. Sewer Shark gave a lot of people their first ever experience of being directly addressed in a human voice by a game with objectives to accomplish.
Hey, relax. Pretend it's a game.
And for demonstrating the potential of a creepy game about exploring and solving puzzles in a haunted mansion, the makers of Seventh Guest brought home bank and reputation, which one half of them would go on to spend to create a softcore psychosexual thriller involving an emotionally disturbed woman mourning the loss of her child, her fuming squawk box of a husband, a live-in psychiatric nurse whose intense need for scandal fucking is severe in a way that would suggest some form of a brain parasite, and John Hurt issuing you flash psych evaluations in various rooms of your house several times a day. Because hubris and innovation go hand in hand. And if you walk along the edge of advancement, you're only one single bad step away from being made to forcibly
hug the shame, boy.
Ooh, strap in, folks. This one's gonna hurt a little.
Nintendo 64, gotta love the glove!
They will utilize their cruelest weapons. They will exploit their most mysterious powers.
He seems to be having a lot of emotional problems in this fight.
As they create an epic non-stop action adventure movie that will challenge your senses. And they will do all this for you in 3D. This summer.
At last you showed your real shit, Sire people.
FBI. Get on it.
Full motion video is one of those terms that no longer means anything to anyone today, because frankly, it's sort of an oxymoron with what today's tech can do. This is where we get FMV from, because it's easier than saying a clunky old term for something nowadays that seems readily apparent. You see video, you assume it's going to be actually fully moving, and not just sprite layers interacting with static or sequential pixel art assets to create what all video games used to look like. That's the thing. Full motion video was really more of a buzzword than anything. Sure, it described video files playing, as opposed to what video output in computers used to be. In practice, though, it was something executives used to dress up the fact that the games they were burning on disc and selling as the latest hot technology were very little more than low-budget movies, chopped into clips, with a UI and player input used to create the illusion of actually doing stuff in a campaign or narrative, instead of just watching files get pulled off a disc and played. You're basically navigating a file system in these games, more than you can make that claim with any other sort. You don't notice it, because here's Michael Dudikoff to tell you that you've walked into a minefield. So your brain goes, oh wait, there's some sort of a scenario I'm involved with. Vaguely. First off though, let's focus our terminology, because FMV was used in a lot of places, but not everything that had FMV could be called an FMV game. Command & Conquer is a series known for its use of FMV in its story and briefing scenes. MechWarrior 4 used it for interactions with NPCs. More recently, Remedy's Quantum Break attempted to mix modern third-person shooting action with real actors and the sort of style and direction you'd see on a prestige format drama. None of these are what I'd call FMV games, and my reasoning is straight up because the FMV is not the main thing occupying your time in these games. Kane just tells you to burn out capitalism and replace it with Tiberium and the mighty technology of peace. You don't then play the front view camera footage of a little Nod flame tank navigating a miniature practical set lighting GDI goons on fire. There's no bad end clip of you getting blown up with an ion cannon strike if you make the wrong turn. You play a strategy game, wreck structures, mine resources, push through, and conquer. FMV games, on the other hand, the video is the main attraction. And this is why you don't see them anymore. Because there's only so much you can do with a single non-linear movie that people are supposed to play, like a game. You can certainly tell a story with these, absolutely you can. But if you want to make one nowadays, you better come with a plan and some major charm, because the FMV genre is the byproduct of a certain time and place in entertainment technology. And just as it always has been, Flash carries just the same weight as substance in this time and place in terms of creating a buzz. It's just that in retrospect, the Flash itself seems really dumb.
Well, 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 look who's here. Another warrior comes a-knocking on my hallowed halls. Beyond this is a challenge from which there is no turning back.
Now to be clear, this idea for games isn't new. It didn't simply spring forth from the forehead of a read-only Zeus, fully formed. Was rather innovated by two men that made a big splash for themselves with their video game. The game? Dragon's Lair. The men? Programmer and hardware specialist Rick Dyer, and animation giant Don Bluth. The game Dragon's Lair could be described as the proof of concept for the QuickTime event as well as the FMV game, because what playing it entails hitting the right direction or the attack button when the game prompts you, then seeing whether or not protagonist Dirk the Daring prevails or dies horribly. Usually it's the death one. Like I said last episode, arcades were a business, and to make money in an arcade meant both getting games that would draw people in and getting games that would empty out pockets. This was why when the CD-ROM drive became a more standard piece of kit in home technology, this concept for a game was just there, waiting in the wings. Now people could bring home the magic of a game that was also a video, with voice and recorded music. Now people could experience the next step forward in digital storytelling. Now...
I underestimated you, Lieutenant. I should have listened to your associate, Mr. Maliano.
People could see in their own living rooms just how limited these games were, firsthand. Our story begins before the ubiquity of CD-ROM technology, in a much better decade, the 80s. In this time that saw the death and rebirth of video games, there were all sorts of people trying all sorts of things. One of those things was a company called Cinemaware, which had an idea. Make games that are like movies. They had some successes, like Defender of the Crown, a Robin Hood-inspired simulation of England in the Middle Ages that frankly looked utterly amazing for the time. This was 1986, and for a company to call themselves Cinemaware with the aim of being movies inside of video games, stuff like this was them demonstrating major chops. 2 years later, they had repeat success with Lords of the Rising Sun, a similar game set in feudal Japan. But they also had a lot of misfires, such as their Three Stooges game, which, while it may have had some interest back when it was new, now just stands as a repository of cursed images. There's also this sound Curly makes in the NES port. It's at this time that I'd like to point out the ending of the actual Stooges bit involving eating the chowder ends with multiple attempted murders via firearm. It's important to know context. And then there's The Crystal, which is a game that is once again proof that sometimes a passion project is just a portal to the area that's so far up your ass, you disappear into nothing. Like you divided by zero. Using your own ass. You get the feeling that were this actually some sort of a new wavy disco science fiction stage play, you'd get that really embarrassing shot of the director mouthing his own dialogue as it's performed. As much as I can get out of this game, it's that you play as some dude that looks like Doug Headache in a landscape of something that someone else obviously thought was really interesting, and then its cover is so hilariously bad, I put it in my opening titles. Cinemaware isn't a super important part to our background here, but its guiding principles are threaded throughout. This is because one of the sorts of people that worked on the thing called Cinemaware was one Rob Landeros, its art director. Landeros is the sort of person you want in that position too, inasmuch that he was a driven, multimedia artist working in the fledgling form of entertainment called multimedia. Even if Cinemaware's games weren't all super hot, they at least looked pretty good to downright great for the time, and Rob was a part of this quality. But Rob didn't stay at Cinemaware. In 1990, along with programmer Graham Devine, yes, one of the Quake 3 devs, badass, the two formed Trilobite. For 3 years, they percolated their concept for a horror experience in games unlike anything that came before. The Seventh Guest was one of the first games released on CD-ROM. Released on April Fools of 1993, it was an interactive journey into a haunted house, created with a degree of care and realism that had never been seen before. If you want to know what the hell a multimedia experience was, what that term marketing executives spun into the new it thing, it's this. Right here. This. To be clear, this is not a game that sold because CD-ROM had become a normal standard thing in computers. No, this was the killer app that made people pick up a new piece of technology and shove it in their computer case. The initial run of 60,000 copies sold out on release day, and Trilobite was inundated with orders for more. Not bad for a game with a production that included blue screens made out of butcher paper and filmed portions shot on Super VHS. Things wouldn't last, despite Seventh Guest's massive splash. The follow-up sequel, The 11th Hour, dropped in the fall of 1995, a year after its initial release date. While a landmark game for being one of the first to use 16-bit color, and once again being visually above and beyond what other games at the time were doing, it had a lot of points of criticism. For one, it was a DOS game, released after Windows 95 had become a pretty standard operating system. So instead of fielding orders, they were fielding complaints from folks that wanted to know why their game didn't work. There was also the fact that while MIDI audio on a disc-based game could fly on the PC, when the tech was new, people were expecting something a little more this time around. And no, once again, MIDI soundtrack, and people were underwhelmed. And then, finally, the puzzles themselves. Namely, people didn't find a lot of them fun, because the solutions were less than apparent in some of the mild cases, and requiring nigh-on sorcerous knowledge to get first time around in the worst cases. Consider what we know now about games. That puzzles are a tightrope walk of holding player interest. And what happens when people slam their face against a solution too well obfuscated for too long? Turns out, it doesn't matter that you're smart enough to completely stump your player base, because when you stump your player base in a game that's meant to be progressed through and solved, that's not good. So the 11th Hour did some big damage to Trilobite, to such a degree that they failed to break even on production. This is a really bad thing to have happen to a game. It's what kills companies. It's probably what killed Trilobite in this incarnation of the company. That death was not instant, though, because Trilobite had a lot of creative people putting down ideas. Unfortunately, none of them could bring the same degree of success as the seventh guest, and it's been said that the relationship between Rob Landeros and Graham Devine became so strained, the last time they spoke to each other was a meeting in 1996. So parallel development became, on multiple projects, as though the company had a line drawn down the center of it. Nothing bore fruit, and Trilobite, as it was, sank in 1999, while Graham Devine was attempting to develop an MMO project, Millennium. Meanwhile, Rob Landeros was working on something a little less easy to describe, an evolution of what he had first worked on in Seventh Guest, yet also very different. It was something that was more cerebral than its haunted house horror, designed for a more mature and introspective audience that wanted something considerably more grown up and raw. Not a game, but an experience that asked the people taking the ride to put more of themselves out there than they might be comfortable with. This was something that he would see to fruition, with the creation of his own company, Aftermath Media. Something to show that games and movies could be more than just the sum of their parts. So, how'd that go? Not well. The question, are games art, is so utterly trite right now. It's become the shortest distance between the two points in terms of mocking empty-headed big think types efficiently. Of course, when the debate started, the importance of the question was to whether or not games were just pieces of entertainment software and not actually culturally relevant of themselves, thereby subjecting themselves to censorship. Real censorship. This was actually important, because the last thing the world needed was people like soulless career Democrat android Hillary Clinton, perpetually clammy yet unpitiable and unlovable Joe Lieberman, or any given interchangeable pasty face and corruption-laced organ mass with a ridiculous name the Republicans cared to trot out and burp up a statement. Their interference could have done damage to a young medium's arc of development. Because if you think games have bad scripts these days, imagine if Kid Thunder wasn't just an Easter egg, but what Mortal Kombat was forced to become. Nowadays, the question, are games art, is used by mewling and frequently Kermit-voiced boys in lumpen men's bodies as an actual reason for why we shouldn't critically analyze games. Because they're art. And as art,
shut up about it, nobody analyzes art ever.
What I'm getting at is that critical softness surrounding narrative and actual cultural elements in games has led to an area where laziness in writing is acceptable, and even expected, as though the opposite is a stupid waste of time. Intellectual laziness can be present in smart people, because it stems not from not understanding a thing, but from not caring to understand the thing. This is why there's been this almost fanatical need for some people that play games to have this sort of cultural killer app that they can point to and say, hey, look, we're actual media too. Artistic license and exploration of themes, wall to wall in this here game. Subtext, bitch! So that need for something deeper has existed since we realized games could be used to tell more complex stories. And where there's a need, people who create will create to fill it. Some of the games that were created to fill this need for a deeper story, deeper emotional resonance, were significant. And many of them, not for the intended reasons. Hey, want to stroll down memory lane? Too bad.
Josh was the only one you ever cared about. And I can help him, if you tell me the truth.
I've killed my soul by playing the victim. This is the only way I can defuse my own sins.
I should have been the one to fill your dark soul with light!
You've done my bidding well, Scorpion. But now I must return you to the Netherrealm.
Up my face.
You see, your choices don't mean anything, and that means everything. This is significant, because a guy who wanted to show us who the real racist
could also be thought it was significant.
That's the thing, yeah? As time goes on, as standards change, we go back and compare how stuff was to how it is now, and observe the evolution. This is something that has been true across all forms of arts, and yes, I can even say martial arts, because look at what we thought competitive martial arts looked like versus what we now know it does. Sometimes, you get works that are huge leaps that advance a form into its next incarnation. Do you want to know why it's so infuriating to hear people talk about this as Kane of games? It's because they keep using it to describe games that are really good, but ultimately conventional, extremely well-polished gems. And that's wrong, because Citizen Kane wasn't just some very good movie. Because before it came along, movies didn't do what Citizen Kane did. Citizen Kane was a highly non-linear film with a number of massive innovations to the medium, made in an era where people were still hunching over huge microphones hidden in set decorations and enunciating dialogue into them flatly and loudly so that people in the back can hear you like it was a play. Citizen Kane was a damn game changer. Keep your superlatives leashed and justified. Just wanting it really hard to be the time for games to be on the level of the best in films and television in writing is ultimately self-defeating.
Going somewhere, Jarek?
Jax! I thought you were going to...
Thought I was what? Dead? Like my partner you just tossed off the cliff?
I'm sorry, Jax. Please, don't drop me. Wait, I promise.
Too late, Jarek.
You can't drop me. You have to uphold the law. You have to arrest me. Wait. This is brutality. You can't do it.
Wrong, Jarek. This is not a brutality. This is a fatality.
Because rather than pushing the boundaries of things being done in the medium, wanting better, it's just making games shiny, pretty luxury things. Polished gems to hold up, hoping that they'll glint off the light from other art forms. If it's the time for games, then I say, let it be time, and let's be brutal but honest towards games, so they can actually develop into something that can be on the level of the best in films, in television, in writing, not just something shiny that seems as though it should be respectable. It's one thing to be better at something someone did before you, but it's another thing entirely to strike out in your own direction, find you've got something, and wind up changing the course of culture. But this is a more sober frame of mind than games have been in most of their life. Frankly, it's pie in the sky for me to say that we're even at this point now. But before now, and on up to this very present day, we've sought out all comers that wanted to try and make something different. In this search, we've put faith in people that we now know we really should have ignored. Some of them, well, they'll get theirs. Where and how these individuals failed were perhaps on a scale more grandiose or just plain old base. Such as, don't have your protagonist fight the Mayan internet. And don't have your female lead fuck a guy who is technically a corpse. These stories have been spoken of. But this one? This one right here? less so. Because at its core, one of the biggest mistakes made was that the game itself was a multimedia experience, released in 1998. And because of that, very few people actually saw it. Given that this game handles some very heavy themes, with about the same level of depthness and sensitivity as V.C. Andrews' House Writer, because that's who actually wrote this story originally, this game's an adaptation. Probably better off for everyone involved that this game's existence stays quiet. If you know anything about B.C. Andrews, or her novel Flowers in the Attic, you might just have had cause to shudder just then. And if you don't know who that person is, or what that book is about, ooh, Lord. Welcome to the Bad Place.
We at the Pizza Hut, we at the Taco Bell. Combination Pizza Hut and Taco Bell.
What greets you when you open Tender Loving Care is something that seems more like a DVD menu than a game. I don't mean to be harsh in describing this as more of a game-like experience than a game, mainly because that's pretty much how Rob Landeros described it. The game is above board with you about what's going to happen, in cloying language. It's going to ask you a bunch of questions, and to proceed, you'll have to answer them immediately. Then you press play and let this cursed VCR spew dread emanations into your eyes. The basic game loop is this. You watch a scene and observe the ersatz human interactions between people who might as well have their general moods worn as black bars on their face. There's Michael Overton, aka Annoyed. There's his wife Allison, aka Shattered. There's her new live-in psychiatric nurse, Catherine Rudolph, a.k.a. Horny. And then there's her teacher, Dr. Turner, played by John Hurt, a.k.a. Better Than This. After watching these entities eject words at each other in sequential order, you're allowed to explore the home of the Overtons, uncovering more of the story through conversations with the cast members directed straight to the player.
Oh, wait a minute, I see. You're the, viewer, right?
Books and notes hidden around the environment, and just generally interacting with things.
Do you like what you see? Good, I thought you would. Now, it's time for your sponge bath.
When you're ready, you can go to a specific room of the house, directed to you by John Hurt himself, to take a thematic apperception test, or TAT. Taking these tests affects both the scenes you see and the ending of the story. TATs are a real thing, in that they've been used in psychiatric evaluations historically. A lot of things have, and we don't use them so much anymore, is what I'll say about TATs. However, this is a game made in a very 90s mindset, which means deeper introspection was on the menu. Just like Frasier, a show about a call-in radio shrink, was one of the more popular sitcoms of the day, people in the 90s wanted to play around with the idea of people in therapy, giving therapy, receiving therapy, and especially fucking up other people with bad therapy.
Jodie's not gonna like her. She's gonna be afraid of her, and she's not gonna like her.
I've been waiting for you!
Because the 90s were also a snake meme decade that liked to tell you what you need and what you didn't. Meaning there was a lot of shade cast on the idea of getting help back in this time. TATs are exactly the sort of thing 90s psychiatry interests fixated on. These things that were supposed to provide a looking glass inward. To tell you how much of a serial killer you were. A little. Or a lot. But the 90s were also a decade of confidence, of capitalistic Western powers basking in a vanquished communism, bravely going forth to state the way things are now. In this case, prosperity is the way things are in Tender Loving Care, because the young Overtons basically live in a mansion in rural Oregon, and this isn't really much of a plot point other than setting up that they live far away from other people, and in the 90s, people didn't need a reason to have a giant house. I mean, look at Home Improvement. Don't look too closely. It hurts. But Home Improvement was meant to be a sitcom about a working class family, composed of a television host, a doctoral candidate, their three sons, and an incredible techno house. Even on Roseanne, a show that was supposed to be about the low end of the middle class, the family still owned their own home. It was just mortgaged. This was the momentum of the American-led Western media. We won. We know what we're doing. Look at our homes. You look at this vision of a time and place, and you see exactly the sort of mindset that would look at a game like Tender Loving Care and go, ah, yes, I certainly have the money to afford this level of new media venture. This was computer introspection for a modern age, an age where people still thought fondly of Ronald Reagan and still thought Bill Clinton was left-wing. Add CD-ROM into the mix, and the form of our tormentor emerges from the foul cauldron in a musky haze of authorial overreach and ham-fisted sexuality. Tender Loving Care is a severe misnomer in this case. In short, husband Michael and wife Allison are not happy. Their daughter Jodie was killed in a car wreck, and that's horrible, so terrible in fact that Allison is traumatized into a state that appears to be naturally stoned at the best of times and childlike at the worst of times, and utterly unable to grasp that Jodie is actually dead. This has not been easy on Michael's own emotional state. Swiss watches are less thoroughly wound than this guy. With Allison unable to function like she used to, the couple seeks relief in Dr. Turner, John Hurt, who suggests a live-in nurse to assist her and provide her with home care. He's quick to suggest his own student, psychiatric nurse Catherine. Catherine, who is queer and also thus evil, sees the image of her dead lover in Allison and plots behind the scenes to disrupt this house of cards. And then Michael and Catherine fuck, because it quickly becomes clear that Catherine is basically a form of mutant shark that needs to violate monogamous relationships in order to survive, and Michael's got less hypnotic resistance than a white investment banker that's been unwittingly dosed with scopolamine. And then everything is terrible. So terrible. The elements as a whole form into a pile and ignite to exactly the sort of trash fire that would have made this story fly off of airport shelves in book form, among people that want to watch a knife get twisted, interspersed with some illicit boning. This is the sort of thing that could constitute a potboiler, back when we were less empathetic towards trauma. Yeah, let's see these crazies tear each other apart. Cage match! It's also a plot that takes real heavy shit and plays with it like wooden building blocks. You're really going to start this thing with the Cinemax humping off with a dead kid game? You're going to continue this thing with the Cinemax humping by escalating to dead dog DEFCON level game? Yes, actually. Because fuck you. This is reality as filtered by the asshole prism of Tender Loving Care. This is the real world, motherfucker. At least we say it is. Everything dies. Everyone fucks each other. Jerry.
Big tornado!
Double German!
If you ever want to watch a piece of media spill hot coffee all over itself, you watch how Tender Loving Care deals with its themes. Hell, look at how its characters communicate with one another.
Good morning. Sorry I slept so late.
Yes, well, we have to get on a schedule, so it's best we start right away.
Okay.
It's like a fucking TCP/IP handshake. There's also the fact that the performance of this parental trauma hits with all the subtlety of a sledgehammer. By the way, pay attention to this sledgehammer.
Time to play the game.
It's not exactly the best thing when one out of the three dominant characters is a mass of exposed nerves, nor the most enjoyable thing to watch. This is not mentioning Michael's sneering or Catherine's vamping, set across the background of an empty child's bedroom and a doll serving as a surrogate Jodie.
Wow!
The fact that Allison is basically infantilized constantly casts a really creepy shadow over the whole affair, and not in any way that feels good or compelling in terms of horror or thriller content.
It's good, isn't it? I found that sledgehammer red paint in the basement.
Time to play the game!
And then there's the sexual component, which is itself jarring in its portrayal. jarring because the degree of how graphic it is swings near the full spectrum of titillation. From plausibly deniable sexual activity to sound the alert horns. That's a hardcore chore coming at us. Seriously, you go from something that could almost be network television in nature to an implied 69 that is only just implied. It's like watching a burlesque, only to get a truncheon slammed across your eyes. A truncheon carved entirely out of Michael being blown. But hey, this thing's both a psychological and erotic thriller, and so being such, the rising action is an escalation of pressure. And this is the right move for this sort of story to make, because thrillers build to an explosion, making the viewers sit on the edge of their seat as to what's going to happen next. You can increase pressure all sorts of ways, by confronting the cast member with newer, more complex problems, or by forcing them to interact in uncomfortable ways, or just twisting the social dynamic in interesting ways. A change in scenery, the introduction of a new threat, the appearance of an interloper that will be dealt with before the end. Tender Loving Care does do some of this, in that it kills the cute dog, because again, fuck you, reality through an asshole prism. But the other way that Tender Loving Care ratchets up the pressure is by repeating its terms to you, louder, more insistently, while mean mugging you from across the room, like a dick. Scene, which I am still unclear if pizza is supposed to be a sexual thing or the actual food with cheese and pepperoni. Maybe it's both. And it's an incredibly dangerous sexual act to perform on one another.
Did you remind him to get the pizza? Oh, that's right, I forgot. We need to get pizza for an appetizer. The house special at the Nimble Hippo in Ashland?
It's 20 miles away.
We'll warm it up when you get back.
I'm not driving into Ashland tonight.
It's been a long time since Jody's had a slice of pizza. She's right, Michael. Jody asked for the pizza.
There's also herbal shampoo, a slammed on button that reminds Michael that he's being suborned by Catherine, who has latched onto him as the weakest wildebeest of the herd.
Well, she killed my dog for one thing, and she blamed it on me. Yes, she did. And she sent me out for pizza and organic herbal shampoo. She's a crazy woman.
There's also these moments that come close to a proper welcome to the fuck shop before veering headlong into uncomfortable, which is when you begin to get the feeling that this game is trying to make you ashamed of feeling anything other than a sense of superiority from all of this art you're taking in. Then there's my favorite moment, and I say that in a way that's purely ironic, but also completely enthusiastic. The scene? Michael, having narrowly missed falling into Catherine yet again, attempts to make his first sensible decision since this whole thing kicked off by choosing to escape in a motor vehicle. For some reason, he chooses this moment to look behind him, just in time to see Catherine remind him that he now wears two leashes, in the least subtle way imaginable. Yes, just like Sir Mix-a-Lot declared he wanted when he was cruising in his Ferrari looking for females and cops.
Cause she put him on the glass, yeah. Put him on the glass.
Somewhere, Fresh Kid Ice felt a reason to smile to himself. And Michael, upon receiving the pressed Amsterdam from his wife's shrink, makes a sound like he's had his ankle snapped in a bear trap made out of dildos. I've replayed this sound hundreds of times at this point. It's one of the funniest things I've ever heard. Welcome to hell, Michael! You live here now! Ultimately, after navigating this blasted hellscape of will they, won't they, oh good lord did they ever, your household navigations and TAT examinations will eventually bottleneck down to one of a few endings. And it's fitting that word, bottleneck, because all endings flow out of this same staircase. What changes is who goes down it, with what degree of lethality, and the consequences of this. The incident that causes the fateful stage dive also comes in one of two flavors. Michael, fed up by having two unhinged women demanding constant sex, attempts to expose he and Catherine's affair to Allison, and Catherine, annoyed by Michael suddenly remembering he's in a monogamous relationship, attempts to throw the surrogate Jodie down the stairs, shattering Allison's psyche. It's also where the sledgehammer comes back into play, because when one character acts, the other picks up the sledge and reacts.
Allison, it's time to face the truth.
Leave her alone!
In the form of just one of the many things that could happen at a Viking wedding.
It's all about the game, and how you play it.
All about control,
and if you can take it.
All about your debt,
and if you can pay it.
It's all about pain,
and who's gonna make it.
I am the game,
you don't wanna play me.
I am control,
no way you can shake me.
I am heavy debt,
no way you can pay me.
I am the pain,
and I know you can't take me.
Hammer surgery complete, there comes the consequences. And it's about this time that you realize there's really no chance of anyone coming out better than they went in. Catherine could survive, and be carted off unable to speak, leaving Michael and Allison further harried but otherwise right back where they started. Michael can also murder her and bury her next to the dead dog, the single dumbest move he could make, causing him to immediately be arrested by the dumb guy police. Catherine could also murder Michael, thus fully becoming Frederica Krueger and as such Allison's girlfriend now. And then there's this variation on the Catherine survives ending.
We used to sit by your crib, watch her breathe. Her little eyelids flutter.
Yeah.
I have a question. I have several questions. Number one, how? Number two, why? Number three, by what authority? Number four, fuck you. You know that scene in Netflix Castlevania where it starts raining blood and malformed, incomplete, larval night creatures? And there's a shot of a guy staring, trying to make heads or tails of this fucked up thing that just fell with a splat nearby? That's me. And that's this ending. Because at the end of the day, this was the sort of mindset that people could operate with in the 90s, and the heyday of the multimedia experience. Who cares what you were seeing as long as you were experiencing it at maximum volume, perhaps for the first time ever. This was the era of total nonsense being burnt and packaged as something meant to be experienced, because way back when, from where we stand now, we were so much easier to wow with our entertainment media. Except, here's the thing. I refuse to believe that anyone was wowed by this, beyond the fact that it might have been someone's first experience with interactive media, you know, individually, person-to-person basis, you know, all kinds of context for how people came to their first game. But, like, not by any other hallmark of playing a game. Because at the end of the day, this piece of media, this thing that is both a movie and a game and just a weird chimera of the two, it's nothing but wall-to-wall bullshit. It's portrayals of human interaction is bullshit. It's psychiatry is bullshit. It's sexuality is bullshit. It's all bullshit. Presented to you on film. Not digital photography, but film. With a real actor and beautiful people willing to get naked. And a piece of rudimentary personality test software functionally serving as a fancy and obtuse DVD scene selection menu. There's no truth here. Nothing to be learned. I hope you never encounter someone suffering from mental health issues if you take anything from this game as information, because, like, shit's gonna get real uncomfortable for you. It's not only wrong, but it's audaciously so, and stated with such a confidence that it's apparent the doubt about the reality and veracity of what's being spoken on never came to mind. It is born out of the confidence where big business income, high dollar, cutting-edge computer tech, and vapid, solipsistic introspection collided in the Western middle class. In other words, could have only come from the 90s.
It's not a game, I'm not a robot, and I challenge you. I'm not a man.
See, it's ironic, because this game was produced by Aftermath Media. And also, they didn't have much of one. It's because that's it, one and done for this venture. And that's despite a stronger-than-average release this game had in Germany. Apparently. I don't know, I can't explain. Someone in Germany, please speak up, because, like, what did they do? What did they do different? There's a lot that I said regarding Tender Loving Care, more than I thought I would have to say, because actually when you get right down to it, there's not much there. And perhaps that's the thing that best suits it, because like the concept of full motion video as a central feature in games, it's big and consuming, but also extremely insubstantial. Whatever I had to say about the actual craft of games in this episode was split with my time being incredulous at the completely ridiculous thought experiment that this game was trying to be. Did you know this game tries to do a gaslighting thing between Catherine and Michael? At no time did I believe that Michael was actually the crazy one, because Catherine gaslights like she's some sort of explosive device filled with magnesium, and any flame will just set her fucking alight visible from the moon, okay? She's not subtle. Succubus. This is neither a mechanic nor a story beat. It's just dreck. But that's just the thing, isn't it? Because people spent the effort, and in doing so, created something that has left them a reputation that's probably much worse than they deserve as artists. And it's not, in this case, because they failed in producing the things. Two companies did. Two. In this case, the thing, the game, came out. But that's just the thing, right? More than games that don't actually make it to market and instead just go off to be some sort of weird, apocryphal nightmare story about, hey, look at how bad the games industry can get. Or worse, these characterless hand shovels of shit that are just clogging up the Steam marketplace these days. Games like Tender Loving Care provoke a strong, nigh overwhelming response. It's like you as an onlooker have been empowered through being wronged by taking it in. Like some sort of sideline nemesis, in reaction to a display of artistic hubris that momentarily elevates you to some sort of demigod being, off a direct injection of the wrath of the gods,
dynamite!
You are compelled to bellow in a voice as wide as the Grand Canyon and as high as Everest, you innovate nothing! You just combined a bad movie with your bad game and called it an experience. Look at yourself in the mirror before you make more of this wank. And I gotta say, for once, it's really refreshing not to be yelling this about David Cage.
The Dexter is criminally insane.
That boy needs therapy.
Psychosomatic.
And that boy needs therapy.
Purely psychosomatic.
That boy needs therapy.
Lie down on the couch.
What does that mean?
You're a nut. You're crazy in the coconut.
What does that mean?
That boy needs therapy.
I'm gonna kill you.
That boy needs therapy.
Granny Gazoo, let's have it, you. How about I count three?
That boy needs therapy.
He was white as a sheep.
And he also made false teeth.